Thank you. Father, I pray for your people. I pray that you give them a testimony today. I pray that you change something about their lives in a powerful way. I pray that none of them will remain at the same level that they came here with. In the mighty name of Jesus, pray that you make them greater in favor, greater in confidence, greater in wisdom, greater in direction. Let their level and position change upward in the mighty name of Jesus. Let every chain on their life be broken. Let every burden on them be lifted. Let every affliction on their life be destroyed. Take them to another level in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You are blessed. Praise the Lord. I would like you to get the songs, and then when we are singing, you put the English songs, you put them on the screen. So those who don't know how to sing them very well can be following. Amen. Today marks the last Sunday that we are talking about developing a godly character. Say developing a godly character. We are talking about things that make you look like God, or that makes you God-like, makes you look like God, or God-like characters that makes you look like God or God-like. And we have learned a number of things. Amen. We've learned that if you are not innovative, you are not like God. If you are not creative, you are not like God. We have also learned that when you are not bold, you are not like God. The Bible said, the righteous or the godly is bold like a lion. But as for the unrighteous, they run away when nobody pursues them. So fear is a sign that you are ungodly. Fear is a nature of ungodliness. Fear is a nature of ungodliness. The godlier you are, the godlier you are, or the more godly you become, the more bold and the more confident you become. So fear is not a nature of God. Fear is a property of the devil. Confidence, boldness, and audacity is a nature of God. Amen. So the more you look like God, or the more you become like God, the more confident you become, the bolder you get. So many of us, like I always say, the only thing we know about God is that He is holy. That's the only thing we know about Him. When we say somebody is like God, he must be holy, he must be righteous, he must be upright. That is the first thing. That one is the first thing. After holiness, after righteousness, after purity, there are other things about God that we have neglected. So somebody is righteous, but Satan is sitting on him. He is holy, but the devil is sitting on him. The devil is messing him up. He is holy, but there are other things about God that he must get to silence the devil. And that one, most people don't have that one. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I said, being godly, first one is holiness, first one is righteousness, first one is uprightness, first one is purity. Another thing about God is that God is a God of faith. If you want to be like God, you must have faith. Anybody who is not walking in faith is not like God. Faith is the opposite of fear. So when you have fear, you don't have faith. The Bible says that God has not given us the spirit of fear. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but He has given us the spirit of faith, which is a combination of power, love, and sound mind. So God is a God of faith. If you say you are a child of God, if you say you are God-like, if you say you are a follower of God, compulsorily, of a necessity, by force, you must exercise faith. You must walk in faith. And faith cannot come without the word of God. It is the word of God that you receive, that you assimilate, that you imbibe, that makes you a person of faith, a word. So you can be very prayerful and still be full of unbelief and fear, because the word is not there. The word is the generator of faith. Say, in the name of Jesus. Because I've just seen something. Say, in the name of Jesus Christ. Anything that has been put on me to make me inferior, I remove it right now. Say, anything that has been put on me to make me ordinary, I remove it right now. Anything that has been put on me to remove me from the selection of the top, I remove that thing right now, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Praise God. Say, Lord, that garment of enlargement, that garment of prominence, that garment of greatness, put it on me. I receive it right now. Say, my original garment that enlarges me, my original garment that makes me prominent, my original garment that makes me respectable, that makes me honorable, I receive that garment right now, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Godly people are not fearful people, they are confident people. Praise the Lord. So when I say declare things, don't declare the thing in a mobile way. Declare seriousness. And mean, declare it, mean you are declaring. Not that they say we are saying something, so I'm also saying something. The things that we declare here, they mean and they have power. So don't just sit down. In the name of Jesus, I declare. No, declare with him. Say thing. Say thing. Because the thing you are declaring is working for you and is going to benefit you. It's going to do you good. So declare it. Praise God. Declare it. I told you, I think in the second service, where I saw through about three refugee-looking Kenyans who entered where the lion was in the game reserve. They were holding some fianga stick. The people, you can see they were hungry. Three men, and there was two men and one small boy. They were wearing earrings, and lions were there. Then these fianga men were walking towards the lion. When the lion saw them coming, the lion took to their heels. Three lions ran away from three fianga men. Inchanga or Inoma. Inchanga is the slim one. Amen. Amen. They saw three Inchanga. Hungry looking men like Somalians. Coming, and then the lions ran away. Say confidence. Confidence. Confidence will make your sickness to run away. I said, confidence will make that witch to run away. I said, confidence will make that opposition to run away. Say, confidence. Yes. Confidence. Even when somebody is stronger than you, you can use confidence to beat him. Confidence alone. That is why when wrestlers are going to wrestle, they give them chance to talk into the microphone. Those of you watch wrestling, and the wrestlers will be talking big words. It's a warfare strategy. Say, warfare strategy. They are using to intimidate their opponents. The words you speak alone can strike your opponent with trepidation, fear, and terror. And once your opponent's confidence is broken, you have won 50% of the battle. Are you understand what I'm saying? Yes. So confidence comes from the knowledge of the word. Praise God. That's why no devil should be telling you that he has overcome you. He has spoiled this. Then you believe it. It's a warfare strategy. Amen. I say it's what? A warfare strategy. You are rather in charge, not the devil, not the witches, not the devil. You are in charge. You must know it that you are in charge. Jesus said, I give unto you power. You must know it. I give unto you power. So any devil who is saying that he has power over you, he doesn't know what he's talking about. He's using warfare strategy. Verbal intimidation. Praise the Lord. He doesn't have it. I said what? He doesn't have it. He doesn't have it. Get the knowledge and let it give you confidence and overpower the enemy. Amen. Silence him. Praise God. Yes. It doesn't matter the adverse conditions around you. You are still in charge. Say, I am in charge by the blood of Jesus Christ, by the grace of God, by the resurrection of Christ, by the death of Christ. I am in charge. Praise the Lord. You can be in the grave and still be in charge. You can be in the lion's den and still be in charge. You can be in the prison and still be in charge. Because the following day, you are becoming a prime minister. Say, I am in charge. Say, I am in charge. Praise the Lord. There's a scripture in Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. It says that, let no man judge you. Let no man judge you. You see, people were telling Jesus that he has a demon when he was on earth. They told him he's possessed. All kinds of things were said about him. The Bible says that, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holiday or of the new moon or of a Sabbath days. You know, it's a strategy of people to judge you. Once they judge you and make you feel like you are not worthy, they are breaking your confidence. They have what? Broken your confidence. And a lot of times they take something from the word of God and they use it to judge you. They use it to judge you. They said to Jesus, you are not even 40 years. And you said you are going to break this temple and build it in 3 days. You are possessed. You are possessed. So people take something from the Bible and they will use it to judge you. The purpose of the word of God is not to judge, is to save, is to give us knowledge, is to open our eyes, is to draw us closer to God. Praise the Lord. Yes. Once something is driving away you away from God, it means something is wrong. So they will take a scripture, and the scripture says that because you are using lipstick, you are a child of the devil. You are a Jezebel. You understand what I'm saying? And you use the scripture. But I have seen something from the word of God that anytime an angel met somebody, God sent angel to the person. The first word the angel says is what? Fear not. That's the first thing the angel says. A messenger from God. A mouthpiece of God. Somebody God has given message to bring to you. Representative of God, because the angel has come as a messenger of God, as a mouthpiece of God, as a representative of God, somebody who is carrying the word of God for you. He has come. The first thing he does, he says, fear not. That is a messenger of God speaking. It removes your fear. That is what a messenger of God speaking. It removes your fear. It takes away what intimidates you. The very presence of the angel alone can intimidate you, can finish you. When the mother of Samson met the angel, he said, hey, I have seen an angel and I didn't die. Because he knew that when you meet an angel, you have to die because you are not clean. So you have to die. He said, hey, I have seen an angel and I didn't die. Hey, was afraid. So a messenger of God comes to allay your fears, assuage your fears, remove the things that intimidate you. Messenger of God removes the thing that disqualify you. He removes it. Praise God. Yes. And comes to tell you that if it were to be based on your qualification, you will never be qualified. Praise God. He says, fear not. Fear not. Fear not. That is a messenger of God speaking. But the one who tells you that you are about to be destroyed, you are about to be doomed, you are finished, you are this, you are that, you are that. He's not speaking from God. Are you learning something?
Yes.
He's not speaking from God. God came to remove people from the pit. God came to remove people from the dead. God came to remove people from destruction. That is God speaking. So the first sign is that he comes to raise your faith, raise your confidence in God, draws you closer to God. That is a messenger of God. Amen. That is a messenger of God. So let nobody judge you. Let no man judge you. Because when they judge you, they are breaking your confidence. It's a strategy. When they judge you, they are breaking your confidence. They are making you to feel that you don't deserve. You are not worthy. And by so doing, you cannot receive anything God is giving you. Once the preacher or that person has said something to make you feel that you don't deserve it, you are unworthy, he has broken your confidence. So when God is giving you something at all, you cannot take it, because you have been made to believe that you're unclean. You're unclean. You don't deserve it. You don't deserve it. God is merciful. Amen. There is a scripture in John chapter 3, verse 18, thereabout. If you read verse 16, it says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Then he goes to verse 17. He sent his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through his son. Amen. Yes. A lot of you, when you see drunkards, you don't want to bring them to church because he's drunk. You want somebody that is clean. No. These are not the people God is looking for. Amen.
Amen.
The clean people are not even in church. They are judging everybody. So they are in the house. So they will not even come to church. Because they see themselves to be self-righteous. They are clean. So they will not come. Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Jesus said, go to the byways, go to the highways, and go and bring them in. I want to work on them. I want to do a thorough work on them. He said, he sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So you come to church for salvation, for deliverance, for restoration, for healing, for rescue. So when you are down, go to church. I said, when you are down, go to church, because in the church you shall be lifted. Amen. He said, thou, O Lord, you are the lifter up of my head. You are my glory. Hallelujah. Amen. So when you come to God, come to the house of God, your head shall be lifted. Your head shall be lifted. I see your head being lifted in the mighty name of Jesus. Continue. Verse 18. It says that he that believeth on him is not what? Condemned. That him, who is he talking about? The son, Jesus. Him. Everything is about him. Everything is about what? Him. Everything is about what? Him. Not a certain church. Not a certain church's doctrine. Not a certain man of God somewhere. Everything is about what? Him. Everything is about what? Him. Everything is about what? Him. Say him. Say him. Everything is about him. Everything is around Jesus. Centered around Jesus Christ. So anybody trying to shift your focus from Jesus and fix it on something else, that is what will make you like God, is destroying your salvation. It's destroying your salvation. All the other things we talk about, they are good, but there's no salvation in it. The salvation is in this man. He's called what? Jesus Christ. Yes. He teaches us how to be like God. If you want to be like God, look at him. Look at Jesus, how he behaves. Tells us how to be like God. He said, he that believeth on him is not condemned. That is the secret. But he that believeth not is condemned already. So you don't even need judgment. Your judgment has been concluded because you didn't believe on the Holy Child of God. Yes. So somebody who is sitting in the house and say, me, I don't smoke. Me, I don't collect bribe. I don't do anything. I'm better than a lot of the people who go to the church. So I'll not go to church. But I'll not accept Jesus Christ. The Bible says such a person is already what? Condemned. Yes. Yes. His eternal location is already determined. So Jesus is the key. Jesus is the key. Why would the person be condemned already? Or why is the person condemned already? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So say the name. Say the name. So there is salvation in the name. The name alone will save you. The name alone will rescue you. The name alone will deliver you. The name alone will cleanse you. Anytime you mention the name, something happens. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Yes, in the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. The name alone will qualify you. So believe in the name. It will make you godly. Believe in the name. Believe also in his blood. Believe also in his blood. There is life in his blood. Praise God. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Say the blood of Jesus. Amen. That is Jesus. Get connected to him. Get connected to him. So as you are coming to church and you receive encounter with Jesus Christ, that is what changes life. That's what changes life. When you encounter Jesus, that is what changes life. Not the customs that we carry out in the church, not the ceremonies in the church, not the rituals in the church, but encounter with this man, Jesus. That is what changes life. That is what changes life. So when you go to churches, you know, Bishop said, he went to preach in a certain church, and the pastor said, Bishop, you remember when Bishop came here? Nanso, because we have elevated our rituals about the word of God. We have elevated our rituals about the word, above the word of God. Jesus is the focus. I said, Jesus is what? The focus. Everything is about Jesus, not somebody's philosophy. Not somebody's opinion. Not somebody's doctrine. Why are we having different churches? Is God a different God? We are all worshiping the same God, though. But why are we having different churches? The reason why we are having different churches is that doctrines have divided us. Doctrines have what? Divided us. That's why there are different churches. We can't be together. But if we were all motivated by Jesus, we will be together. Amen. Somebody said, because you are very weak, you are from the devil, I will not associate with you. It's not Jesus. It is a doctrine. Amen. Yes. And he can get it from the Bible and prove it to you, and he will use it to judge you and condemn you. But messengers of God, what did they come? They remove your fear. They don't intimidate you. Somebody will say, because of your haircut. One day somebody said to a man of God, I've been listening to you on radio, but the day I saw you on TV and I saw your haircut, I knew that you are not of God. I've been listening to you on radio. You are very powerful. You are a very good man. I've been preaching the truth. But because the day I saw your haircut, I knew that you are not of God. Say haircut. Yes, haircut. Not Jesus. Now it is haircut we use to determine. Not Jesus. Not this one. Yes. So Jesus make you God-like. Amen. Yes. Somebody too said, because you are wearing earring, because you are wearing earring, the children of Israel use gold to do idol in the Garden of Eden. So any earring you are wearing, it means you are an idol worshiper. So you are not of God. Yes. He is not wearing earring. And he has refused to wear the wedding ring, but he's wearing watch, which is also metal. The watch is also metal. Praise God. The watch is also metal. He's wearing spectacle. The spectacle, so there is what? Metal inside. That one, we can mold it and use it to do idol. But he's wearing spectacles. He shouldn't wear spectacles. Say godliness. Say godliness. Yes. He's driving a car. The car that is what? Metal. He should stop driving the car and start walking. Praise the Lord. He's driving a car. There is metal inside. We can use, mold it to do something. There's metal inside. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Jesus is the thing. He gives us the salvation. He gives us the redemption. He gives us the godliness. Say Jesus, I love you. Say Jesus, I worship you. Say Jesus, I praise you. So a lot of the things we focus on have divided us. And the thing that has must put us together, which is Jesus Christ, we have forgotten about it. We are not talking about it. Because all the divided churches, they all believe in Jesus. They all worship Jesus. But because the focus is no longer on Jesus, and the focus is on other things, we are divided. We are divided. Amen. Amen. Yes. So when you see somebody on the street who looks unclean, don't say because I go to church, he doesn't go to church. He is not of God. Bring him to the Lord. Let him encounter Jesus and he will be changed. Amen. Amen. I remember some time ago, my bishop went to do a crusade somewhere. And the people who were Christians there, the leaders told their church members not to go and help the bishop to do the crusade. I will not mention the name of the church. Because they thought he was coming to collect their members. Praise God. So they warned their church members, none of you should go there. And the church members didn't go. It was a certain drunkard who did interpretation for the bishop into the Akan language. A drunkard, say a drunkard. Say a drunkard. Say a drunkard. When Jesus is there, the drunkenness is deleted. I said, when Jesus is there, the drunkenness is what? Deleted. Amen. And the miracles that happen. I said, the miracles that happen in that school. Say, drunkard interpreting, miracles happening. Praise the Lord. God could have said that because the interpreter is a drunkard, his drunkenness has made the bishop dirty. So God will not move. Praise the Lord. Jesus is higher than drunkenness. I said, that name Jesus is higher than what? Drunkenness. It's higher than anything. Once you mention Jesus, it removes the thing. I said, once you mention Jesus, anything that is blocking the way, Jesus will remove it. Praise the Lord. Somebody say Jesus. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. We must focus on the writing. Jesus. We must focus on the writing. Jesus. There is life in it. There is forgiveness in it. There is power in it. There is holiness in it. There is transformation in it. Jesus can make a barren person to give birth. Somebody say Jesus. Jesus can heal the sick. Praise God. Yes. So we must stop focusing on the lighter things and focus on the right things. One of my brothers, he got born again first in our family. Very prayerful. Now he has backslided. I'm still praying for him to come back. Amen. He gave a story or a testimony of how some demon came to attack him in the night. And he mentioned the name of our family idol. When he mentioned the name of the family idol, the attack went down small. Then attack came again. It went down small. It came again. Now, when you mention the name of the family idol, the attack doesn't go again. Now the attack is coming to finish him. Then he shouted Jesus. When he shouted Jesus, the attack didn't go and come again. It was totally uprooted. It was totally uprooted. It was totally uprooted. Praise the Lord. That is why Muslims, even in accident cars, they mention who?
Jesus.
They forget themselves. And they forget themselves. They know the thing, but they are forcing. You understand what I'm saying? They know where the life is. They know where the power is. Yes. So we need the Muslims. We have to bring them to God. We need them. They are sincerely looking for the truth, but they are sincerely deceived. I said what? They are sincerely looking for the truth, but they are sincerely deceived. Jesus is the way. Amen. The other day, a Muslim brought their daughter here, who was being attacked by witchcraft powers. They were giving her egg in the dream that she should eat it by force. And as long as she was not eating the egg, she became sickly. She couldn't sleep. They were tormenting her. She couldn't go to SS. Right? And the Muslim woman brought the daughter here. The mother was a Muslim. The daughter was a Muslim. But when I mentioned Jesus, Jesus removed Muslim. He put Muslim aside. He put Islam aside. And then, yeah. Amen. That girl who could not sleep after Jesus was mentioned and we prayed, she went to, she slept and slept and slept and slept and slept and slept. Because the demon feared Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? The witches feared Jesus. She slept. Then the mother was afraid that the daughter is going into coma. And that girl too couldn't eat. She slept, she woke up, she ate. And she slept again, she woke up and ate. Hallelujah. So, because of Jesus, she will eat, she will sleep, she will shit, she will wake up, she will eat again, she will sleep, and then she will shit. Jesus brought her salvation and deliverance. Amen. Look, shitting is a blessing. I'm telling you, some people cannot shit. I'm telling you, some people cannot shit. Hey! We yam and chew for 1 week. That we yam chew for 1 week. Now tell me, cut all of that. You know, say shitting is a blessing. I've been told that. Praise God. It's a blessing. When you can shit, just thank God. You see, we take things for granted. We take things for granted. You can die out of lack of shitting. Let me use the word so that you understand it well. Praise God. Yes. Now when you are releasing the thing and the thing has become hard like stone and it doesn't want to come, then you know, say, life, amen. We are taking all the medicine, but still, the thing is hard. Then, yes, it has made people to get kokobo because of what? Shitting problem. Yes, shitting problem made them to get kokobo. Let no man judge you. Amen. Anyone who believes in the name of Jesus Christ is saved, is not condemned. Which voice is condemning you? Some people are condemning you. They say some things that because you are not married, with your own come. Because you are not this, own come. That is not the main thing. The main thing is what? Jesus. Amen. Yes, we don't need to count because you don't have money. You are not there. You are not counted. That is not the main thing. The main thing is Jesus Christ. Amen. So in the church, the big man and the small man can sit together. The rich man and the poor man can sit together. The one at the top and the one down, they can sit together. Because there is one thing that unites us. That thing is called what? Jesus Christ. Yes, called Jesus Christ. Praise God. I have not touched my message though. This was a message God gave me when I came here. So what I've written in my book, I have not read. This was a message. So that's a message God gave me when I came to the church. Let me read this scripture in Job chapter 8, verse 6. Job chapter 8, verse 6. He says, if you were pure and upright, surely now he will awake for thee and make the habitation of thy righteousness prosperous. Is it on the screen? He said, if you were what? Pure, say purity. And upright, say uprightness. He will awake for thee and make the habitation of thy righteousness, say righteousness, prosperous. So you see purity, you see uprightness. You see righteousness. All those things make you godly. Amen. Purity, righteousness, uprightness. They make you godly. But he said that if you are pure, you are upright, you are holy, God will awake for you. God will what? Awake for you. Daniel was in the lion's den, but God would awake for him. Lions could not eat him. God was active. God took action for Daniel. So if you stand for God, one of the things that make you pure is to stand for God. Is to what? Stand for God. Don't be an elder in the church and then a certain church has come to your office to look for something, and because that church is not your church and you are an elder in the church, you are trying to hinder that church. You are not for God. Many of the offices you go to do things for church, and people fight you. Some of the people, they are leaders in the church. They are leaders in the church. Instead of them to stand for God, like, this thing that they have brought to the office, it is the name of a church. That church stands for God. Instead of them to stand for God, they will not stand for God. Yes. Many of us are against God in many ways. In many ways. When you hear anything about God, don't fight it. See how you can push it. Because of God. Not because of that man. Because of God. See how you can push it. God will bless you. Tell God, this thing I'm doing it because of you. God will bless you. God will bless your descendants. God will protect your children in the time of trouble. Yes. Do something for God. Do something for God. Amen. Yes. God shall awake for you. We must stand for God. We must stand for God. Policeman meets somebody. By force, he wants to collect money from the person. You don't know the person you are dealing with. You want to collect money from him by force. You don't know the person on the road. You don't know the person you are dealing with. You want to collect money by force. It's not money you want. Take it. And as you are collecting the money, you are bringing something on yourself and your descendants. It's not everything we collect. So when you stand for God, God will awake for you. Amen. When you stand for God, God will awake for you. One day, when they did the ban on drumming, certain man was doing, calling people to come and cause problem here. And I met him, I told him, you are dealing with God. You are dealing with God. Within a twinkle of an eye, that breath you are using to call people to come and disturb our service, the God we are dealing with, within a twinkle of an eye, that breath you are using, if he takes it from you, can you take a phone and call somebody that go and attack the church? People don't know the seriousness of what they are doing. But they will not say go and attack the mosque. Yet the mosque has put microphone outside. The church speakers, they are inside. You have not put it outside. You have put it inside. And you have lowered it. Yet you call people to come and attack us. They don't know the seriousness of what they are dealing with. They don't know. There are times as a pastor, you meet some people. You pray all your prayers for them. But because their father has done something against God, God is against them. Some of these things, when they do, fight themselves, fight their children, fight their children's children. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes. It's not everything we say. God will awake for you when you stand for Him. God, Nyankopon, obe nyanya mao, obe kenya nihun amao. God shall awake for you. God will spare himself for you if you stand for him. That's why anybody who is preaching on the road, whether he has put box there and is collecting money, I don't talk so. I don't talk against him. Praise the Lord. Yes. One thing I like about him is that he's telling somebody about God. That's all. It's enough. Praise God. He's not telling people about condoms. He's telling people about what? God. He's not making a bet for condoms. Praise God. He's not doing it for even a party, political party. He's doing it for God. Yes. And when I'm walking on the roadside with my children in my car and I see somebody preaching, I take money and give him. God will bless me. Because what he's doing is of God. He's creating awareness about God. God is happy with it. Give him money. creating awareness about God, because everything about the world is driving people away from God. Everything about the world is turning people against God. Everything about the world is making people to hate God and to dislike God and to dislike the things of God. So people now are ashamed to talk about God or to identify with God. When you see somebody who can openly identify with God in your office, in your workplace, and telling people, come and let's do morning devotion. There are times when we go to the banks and somebody in there is says that let's do morning devotion before we start work. Work starts at 7. Let's do morning devotion 6 to 6:30 or 6:30 to 6:55. Then you see people working in the bank who attend churches fighting the thing. And when you do that, God has seen you. God will not be happy with you. God will not be happy with you. Anything about God, the only thing is that let's do it right. Amen? Yes. Let's put it at the right time. Do it. You shouldn't be eating into the working time unnecessarily. Let's do it right. And God will bless you. Promote God at where you are working. I said what? Promote God at where you are working. Yes. So when you stand for God, God will not sit down and look for you. They put the guys in the fire because they stood for God. And when they stood for God, God awoke. God woke up for them. And the fourth man appeared in the fire. Praise the Lord. Anytime you stand before God, it justifies you. Anytime you stand for God, anytime you stand for Jina Homer Radia, a booming. Who said, you know, Abom Yesu, Abom Yesu. Praise God. Abom Yesu. Amen. Last time I went to Jolo to preach, I said, they should give me local songs. They should give me local. Give me locals. Amen. Local, no, any day, who home, never. Utua, now, who home, neither. Abba, local. Praise God. That is just by the way. So God will awake for you and you make the habitation of your righteousness prosperous. So godliness brings prosperity. Godliness brings what? Prosperity. Continue serving God, you shall succeed. I said, continue serving God, you shall prosper. Continue serving God, it shall be well with you. Continue serving God, you shall make it in the name of Jesus. Say, my Father, arise for me. Say, my Father, awake for me in the name of Jesus. Say, Holy Ghost, anything in my life, anything around my life that is questioning the presence of God in my life, oh God, arise, awake, shake yourself, stir yourself, and silence every opposition, every limitation, every hindrance, every attack upon my life, upon my destiny, upon my finances, upon my work, in the name of Jesus. Say, oh Lord, anything about my life that is making me a disgrace, anything about my life that is making me a byword, that is making me a mockery, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus, I erase it, I delete it, I remove it, I uproot it, I cancel it, in the name of Jesus. Say, oh Lord, let a new garment of glory come upon my life. Let a new garment of beauty come upon my life. Let a new garment of acceptance come upon my life. In the name of Jesus, oh Lord, I declare, make me an asset. Make me valuable. Make me useful. In the name of Jesus Christ. Say, right now, anything in the spirit that is making me forgotten, that is making me valueless, that is making me useless, oh Lord, in Jesus' name, I erase it, I delete it, in the name of Jesus. Say, right now, evil powers reducing my value, evil powers reducing my value, evil powers canceling my value, break and scatter in the name of Jesus. So evil powers making me to look useless, to look valueless, break and scatter, break and scatter in the name of Jesus. So right now, my value increase, my value increase, my value go up, my acceptance rise in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Say right now, every power making me small, making me belittled, making me little, making me nothing, break and scatter, break and scatter in the name of Jesus. Say, oh Lord, anything about my life, about my loved ones, causing me pain, causing me sorrow, causing me reproach, bringing me setback, oh Lord, let the name of Jesus visit that situation. Let the name of Jesus visit that situation, and let there be a change. Let there be a change. Let there be a change. In the mighty name of Jesus.